good morning, everybody. Jenny, thanks for that lovely introduction. I think we're going to go with complicated optimist today, because I'm not sure there's any way that we can take on a topic as rich as this one without having our optimism complicated somewhat, and we have a wonderful panel to help us with that today. Luis has really set us up for a wonderful conversation. All of us are excited about this idea that the data that we're collecting intentionally, unintentionally, could be used to really transform how we think about social change. That we might find unexpected insights, perspectives that we didn't have before, the ability to ask really complicated questions and get answers from the field and have insights on issues of global health, migration, rights, that we simply couldn't take on because we just didn't have the information previously. But a lot of these hopes are still pretty nascent. And at the same time that we're trying to work through these ideas, we also realize that there are some threats that are also nascent. So we're really asking to look a little bit into the future. How do we prepare for a world that's really being transformed by big data? And how do we prepare in a way that we're able to make intelligent decisions about what we want to protect and how we want this change to take place? So what we have is a group of four folks who are pretty much who you would choose to ask for a distant look into the future. It's an utterly extraordinary panel. If I properly introduced all four of them, it would take the next 45 minutes. So what I'm going to do instead is improperly introduce them in the course of asking them to talk a little bit about the work that they're doing around these issues and challenges of big data. And I'm going to start with Esther Dyson, who is an investor, a philanthropist, I think one of the most insightful thinkers about technology and change. Right now, someone who's doing an enormous amount of thinking about technology, genetics, health, in her role as a board member of 23andMe. Certainly, the human genome has almost as much information as in that Citibank agreement we were just looking at. What might we get out of understanding and starting to learn about the genome, Esther?
Okay, well, just also for the record, not only am I on the board of 23andMe, but my entire genome, the big one, is actually online, publicly available, along with a small number of my health records at personalgenomes.org. And the reason I say this is there's this, and it's a reason you started with me, which I would argue it's not the most interesting. The reason genetic information is attracting so much attention now is, number one, it's really, really new. And back in the old days, when people looked into a mirror, they thought they could see the devil behind the person. It was creepy to see an exact image of a person. In the same way, a lot of people think it's creepy to see your DNA. It's not like most of what we do. We're used to being chemical, physical, analog, and it's a digital representation of a person. It is almost unchangeable. It's uniquely identifiable, except maybe if you're an identical twin. So people fear it. They think it reveals the future. It's got all this secret information about what's going to happen to your health and when you're going to die and all this stuff, which is flat out not true. I'd much rather get, you know, three or four data points about a person, some of the biomarkers in their blood, their body mass index, their age, you know, maybe the condition of their eyes or something. I can make much, much better predictions, or I can just run a family history and make better predictions than I can off the genome. Nonetheless, people think it's this magical thing. What's actually really interesting about the genome is when it moves from being digital to analog, how do those digital things turn into proteins? How do the proteins fold? How do the proteins unfold and interact? And so just like all the rest of big data, what's interesting isn't the data, but the meaning you can derive from it. Regardless, people are worried also that it uniquely identifies people. So there are issues around, again, privacy. You just left some saliva on that glass. Now we can track you all around the world. There are usually better ways to track people than their saliva. So I'll leave it there, but it's, and come back to it later.
I encourage you all to download a copy of Esther, either now or sort of later. I keep a copy on my laptop. I have to say I've felt better about myself and my life in general ever since I have. I'm going to go on the other side. I'm going to go to Sir Tim Berners-Lee. I've gotten special dispensation to use the Sir. It normally doesn't get used outside of the UK. But Tim is responsible for creation of the World Wide Web, really transforming how many of us think about the world of data and how we interact with it on a daily basis. I would like to say he's also personally responsible for me dropping out of graduate school, which is the best decision I ever made. I'm grateful to him all the time for that. Tim is now focusing his energies on the World Wide Web Foundation, which is looking at the idea that the web could be an incredible transformative force for social good, which is an issue that I know a lot of us in this room are engaged with. Tim, what are you learning about the web as you start looking at the challenge of governments in the developing world, as we start looking at what we can learn about how countries are governing their people?
Okay, now, beforehand, I should say, we did have a little chat, and that, at which point you said that what you'd like me to talk about is about government data. Now, of course, and the Web Foundation, in fact, has in fact, more or less been asked specifically to go and look into government data in the developing world. But in general, but that question is much more broad about what should governments be doing. So let me try to quickly do the broader one. There's an awful lot of things that governments need to be doing. Though if you go to thewebindex.org, then this is a recently launched index, which is put together over lots and lots of different numbers. Lots and lots of surveys, over 61 countries, giving each one a number to attempt to say, look, as far as we can say, for your country, this is how well you're doing. And it includes lots of things. So, for example, it includes, have you got good, is your legislative system and your regulatory system suitable so that you will actually get people onto the net, have you got connectivity, but it's very much more than that. That's a small part of it. Well, it's also about the content. For each of the people in your country, take their mother tongue. How much stuff is there on the web? How functional is the web in that language? Which obviously is a kind of a free ride for everybody who speaks English, and soon will be for anybody who speaks Chinese languages. But if you speak a dialect, one of the Indian dialects, then it may be a different issue. So the different things are different issues in different places. And the top layer of it is the impact. Is this actually having an impact? Is it changing the way people do politics? Is it changing the way people do healthcare? Is it actually having an economic effect? Is it having an effect on education? Sometimes it's having an effect on education, which can then have a good effect on healthcare, and so on. So it's got these three stripes, I suppose, the impact stripe, the content stripe, and the underlying infrastructure piece, and you can go to the webindex.org. And so that attempts, when you look at that, obviously, different countries are going to be in different situations. And for each one, the idea is if they think, okay, so what should we do now? They should be able to look at the web index and see how to make it larger. We'd be very interested in talking to people about what should be in the next one. We've released one. It's going to come out yearly. And what's in it, the contents of it, will change bit by bit. And now, of all these things, one of the things, perhaps under the impacts on politics, is, by the way, do you have open data? Now, open data is something that I've actually personally, with various different hats on over the last few years, been spending a lot of time jumping up and down about. I was lucky enough to be sitting next to Gordon Brown when he was Prime Minister at a lunch, when he'd finished talking to Bill Clinton, who was on the other side of him, as the course changed, he talked to me and he said, "So Tim, what should the UK do to make the best use of the internet?" And he said, "You should put all your government data on the web." And he said, "Okay, let's do that," which was staggering. I've never, you know, had somebody say, "Okay, yes," in all my campaigning. it's like pushing on the door and suddenly it opens. So we had a quick project, and that sort of put the UK very much in the lead of putting data on the web. And the reason that I wanted to put the data on the web, let me say, is that there's huge amounts of data which is just an economic benefit. It's sitting there on some disk, on some agency in government, And it could equally well be sitting on a public server. It's probably more expensive to keep it behind security than to just keep it open, because security is expensive. And just making it open just makes the whole thing run better. Often, people inside the government can use it more effectively. Because even within the government, even though they formally have access to it, they would have to make some kind of a request up. So it just makes the government run better. It makes industry run better. In some cities, when you get out your phone and you look at the map, and whether or not depending on what type of map you have on there, you can get directions. And in some places, you can not only get directions by car and by bike and by foot, but also by public transport. Sometimes you can't. What's the difference? It's that the public transport information, the schedule data, which a map needs to figure out how you can get from there to there, some places, that's all being provided, for example, to Google using a format they put forward. And so that everybody can write an application to figure out how to get from one place to another by public transport, and so this actually reduces the number of people who go by car. In other places, you find that a bus company has signed an exclusive deal to only give the schedule information to the local newspaper. Okay, what's wrong with this picture? So the thing about this data is its value is when you connect it to other data. It's not the bus company's data is not really interesting. It's not a massive, like contract is not a massive asset for the local newspaper. But the fact that it's missing means you can't look across the city as a whole and figure out how to get from one place to another. And working out the value to the economy of being able to get from one place to another just by looking at your phone. It's really, really hard to calculate. You get these massive returns on investment, but they're very hard to calculate. So for most of the data I'm talking about, it's data which already exists. It is not personalizable at all, so privacy does not apply. The bus schedules are not an issue. Massive amount of the data, the majority of the data in government, the privacy thing doesn't apply. Transparency is a really important benefit, and in developing countries, which is you wanted me to mention particularly, it turns out that the transparency is a really important issue.
So we're gonna get I think a lively discussion about figuring out how we open government data and what are the upsides and the potential downsides around this. In sort of taking this broad view and sort of asking people to look towards the future, I'm gonna turn to Caitlin Thaney, who's the manager of external partnerships for digital science. She's a passionate evangelist for scientists sharing information, often around open standards. Now, hanging out with a lot of scientists at MIT, I realize how hard it is to get people to share. What's the promise that we see from science in taking the data that we're all individually generating and finding ways to share it?
Well, I think at least in thinking about some of the takeaways that we hope to have for Wire for Change, and then also some of the work that I do on the research side, both in academia and then also with industry, there's three main areas that I think are probably most exciting in terms of the way that it's changing our methods of thinking and also our methods of engaging. So one of those being the method of engagement. I err on the side of not calling it collaboration because the example I'm about to give, I don't think that it necessarily is collaboration in its truest form, or at least has been pushed as far as it possibly could, but the means of how we engage with others externally and also internally. Also the means of how we understand. So I mean, going to Esther's example about how we can understand both personally our own health, but also how that can be matched and paired against other data sources. And finally, just how it's affecting the accountability. And I know in the video there was a number of mentions about how we can empower the users and how we can also use it for more transparent uses in government, but also in research and a number of other different manifestations. So a couple of examples to sort of hinge upon that, because in the sciences, it's almost more frustrating, especially having discussions with those in the data community outside of academic research, because they think, it must be so amazing to be able to have access to all of this information and all of this data exhaust, because then you can start to do the sophisticated machine learning and all of this analytics and things without realizing that the perception issue is still stymieing that whole process, so that much of that information isn't actually saved or available. And when you're talking about perhaps the most important enterprise and longest running one of our existence and our humanity in terms of understanding disease and finding cures for new ailments, it's a real travesty. But when it comes to the engagement aspect of things, there's been some really interesting shifts when it comes to, you know, in my world, the enterprise world of, say, pharma. I'm not saying that it has pushed it nearly as far as it should, but, you know, companies like Eli Lilly that are trying to take what they have and find new means of inviting the public and inviting researchers in, taking some of the data that they have and some of the in-house resources when it comes to the assays and the catalogs for, say, tuberculosis, and opening that up so that there's a portal that people can come and try to run their own bits on. Or, say, GlaxoSmithKline, who released over 13,000 compounds into the public domain, which is astonishing for malaria, but now are moving even further than that. Now, is it necessarily the right form of collaboration? Maybe not. We had a number of conversations back when I was actually living in Boston, where we're surrounded by pharma and biotech, about all of these various strategists that were coming together after the fact, many that had moved into academia or into other jobs since, saying, oh, why didn't we think about sharing all those resources around P38? You know, we all invested billions and trillions of dollars on that, and we probably could have found something, because not a single drug went to market out of all, you know, maybe four or five of the main companies going through. But it really is interesting to watch that transgression, not only in terms of engagement and how people are trying to look a bit into the unknown, and I think that's where there's a really nice parallel with philanthropy of saying, we don't necessarily know what the ramifications may be, but it's really important to start to do it so that we can start to better map, you know, our return on investment, however you may measure that. And also for using the GlaxoSmithKline example, the recent announcement about making their clinical trial data available, and I know that there have been a number of friends in the UK and the US that have been campaigning for better access to this resource, because in that case, it's not just that data is locked up, it's, you know, opacity is leading to distrust, it's leading to harm for those that are being prescribed drugs that, you know, could work completely against them, and that accountability is really important, and you're seeing a shift in transparency, and also in academia to have more reproducible science, because if we can't build on what's being published, that's why publication even came into being, then, you know, what are we doing?
Absolutely.
I just want to add one coda, both for government data and medical data. The word, or the API, application programming interface, it's not enough to put the data out there. It needs to be in a form that you can take it and mash it up with other data so that you can compare the drugs people take to their medical outcomes. So getting stuff on a PDF or getting a fax of a medical record is, it may be open, but it's not usable.
Sorry, I have to say at this point, I do have a 5-star scheme for data. And you get 1 star. Okay, 1 star for putting it out, 2 stars for putting it out not as a fax, 3 stars for being, so 1 star for putting out at all, big star one, 2 stars if it's actually a machine readable form, 3 stars if it's not a proprietary standard, 4 stars if it actually uses the linked data standards, and 5 stars if you've linked it. So thank you. Yes, you should use the standards. I kind of have to say mention the 5-star.
Before we get too deep into the nature of how we open the data, just sort of quickly reviewing sort of the points so far. Open scientific data gives us the possibility of accessing problems that we haven't been able to solve individually. Open government data gives us the possibility of increased transparency and being able to build applications with government data that we haven't had access to. Genetic data, if we're brave enough to open it up, if we try to figure out how to do it, if we make ourselves downloadable, has the possibility of thinking about health in some very different ways.
You don't need to publish it. You can also leave it anonymous and just give it to research.
I am merely teasing you. I now want to turn to Jaron Lanier, amazing, multifaceted individual, computer scientist, composer, musician, writer, who's been thinking really deeply about some of the implications, not all of them positive, of moving towards these models of openness. And I wonder if you'll sort of react to
the three statements so far. Well, look, first of all, I love big data. I work with big data. For many, many years, starting decades ago, I was one of the early advocates of opening everything up, and all the positive claims are not only true, but I think even truer than we know yet. So no argument there. I am concerned, though, that we've made a mistake of thinking that there's only one way to make data accessible, that there's only one way to open it, and that that one way is kind of on the what you might call the Linux model of putting everything out there in an utterly open way. And So I'm going to say something that will strike a lot of people as being weird on first hearing, but I've come to believe, based on empirical observation, that actually is turning out to be a mistaken path. It came as a surprise to me that it was. I started to feel that it wasn't working out well around the turn of the century. And let me explain what I think goes wrong with it. The first issue is that if you have a whole bunch of open data and a lot of people have access to it, it's not true that they're all equally empowered. What happens is the best technical people with the biggest computers, with the best bandwidth to those computers, become more empowered than the others. And a great example of that is a company like Google, which for the most part is just scraping the same internet and the same data any of us can access, and yet is able to build this huge business of directing what links we see in front of us, which is an incredible influence on the world by having the bigger computers, the better scientists, and more access. It doesn't create a world of equals. Now, even that, okay, the life isn't fair, so that in itself is not a terrible thing. However, what I've observed is that while this style of openness might indeed do a lot for the least empowered people in the world, it might help people overthrow a dictator now and then and that sort of thing, it has a negative effect on another population that might be the very most important to democracy and well-being and stability, and that's the middle classes. So let's talk about the middle classes for a second. The middle classes, in a way, are an affront to mathematics. And the reason why is that if you look at, and this is a whole long argument, and I just wrote a book about it. There's no way I can entirely summarize it. But if you make a very efficient market system where incomes and other outcomes are distributed according to what we call a power law, a very efficient one will tend to have a long tail and a high peak and not a very thick belly, to speak from experience. So the way that this middle class belly happens is actually through the creation of a multitude of ad hoc exceptions to a totally open, efficient market. And these are things like unions and royalties and copyrights and academic tenure and taxi medallions, although those can be abused. All of them can be abused. So there's this whole world of ad hoc exceptions that create little levies or little cup holders of the flow of capital in the middle. And this has turned out to be the most workable system for creating sustainable democracy. Trying to create a communist system that rejects the flow creates horrors because you just create a new center of power. Absolutely giving in to laissez-faire flow, you lose that mountain of exceptional benefits, which creates a middle class. So that's the best solution we've had so far. Now, the problem is that when you have information systems that are able to be superior just sort of in an a priori way by having the best computers and so forth, you create these massive efficiencies that concentrate wealth and power at the expense of all of those in-between special cases that created the middle class. So a great prototype example is what happened to the music business. So I used to be a professional musician. I mean, I'm still a professional musician, but I used to do really well with records. And there's this sort of social illusion that there are all these people doing great because you can raise money on Kickstarter or something, but this is really Horatio Alger territory. I've done a lot of work collecting numbers, real big data, on how many people are surviving in the music business these days compared to 12 years ago. And it's terrible. I mean, we're down to between a quarter and a third on a global basis and a tenth in some countries. I'll do it really fast. The issue here is that as we enter the information age, more and more industries become about information. We're going to start to have 3D printers replacing factories at some point. No one can say what year. In the new book, I describe a technology for implantable artificial glands that can synthesize pharmaceutical compounds so we can disintermediate the pharmaceuticals and Napsterize them. And then there'll just be some computer server somewhere that makes all the money. And as this happens, we either face a world of huge unemployment and a few peaks of the people who are close to the big computers, or else there's this other alternative that's better, which I'll describe in the next go-round.
I'm going to let you get to the other alternative in the next round. Just to sort of summarize this, as I understand your argument so far, it's actually very similar to what Luis warned us about, which is this idea that in a space where an enormous amount of data is available, in many cases, the people who are most empowered by it are the people who have the ability to access and process enormous amounts of that data. To make an analogy to the work in the space that I work in, I work largely in the international human rights space, we're very worried about mobile phone providers in dictatorships for the simple reason that that's where you concentrate everyone's movement information. That's where you concentrate information on who talks to whom. And if that's not highly protected, in a closed society, that gets extremely worrisome. So for all that we're excited about, what we're excited about with open government data, open pharmaceutical data, open genetic data, I'd love to sort of ask everyone on this panel sort of what aspect of this are you most worried about? And I'll put out, I am simply most worried about mobile phone companies. What keeps me up at night in a cold sweat is mobile phone companies. What keeps you up at night?
Some very different things. First of all, I just want to tell an anecdote about information and so forth. In Russia last December, there was one of several big demonstrations. This one was mostly about voter fraud. And there's a, for what it's worth, there's a little iPhone app called Witness, which is a poll monitoring app. It's awesome. If you've never known how to monitor a poll, it looks like the Ford Foundation helped fund it. It guides you through it. It's got a little wizard for how to monitor a poll. So the head of elections is a guy called Churov. He said, no problem. So someone marches down the streets of Moscow carrying a large sign showing some big data, some graphs. One is the election results, and another is a Gaussian distribution, the mathematician Gauss, that I hope you've heard of. And so the caption on it is, only an informed and intellectual society would have appreciated, we do not believe in Churov, we believe in Gauss. people are empowered by this data. It's amazing. What disturbs me is much more subtle. I think we're losing hypocrisy and aspiration. You see people behaving badly everywhere. Lindsay Lohan is a star. I mean, it's not that people were so well behaved in Victorian times, but at least they aspired to be. As we make everybody visible and make human failings, you know, I'm less worried about privacy. I think everybody who ever smoked dope is going to be excused. Everybody who cheated on their college exams.
Are we excused now?
No, just if you run for office.
Oh, okay.
See, I'm really screwed because I never smoked it.
Yeah. So, I mean, you can talk about privacy and abuse and all these things, but I think there are other subtler things. To Jaron's point, the middle class will not disappear. A lot of the health stuff I'm doing, it's obvious if you run 2 miles a day and you eat right, you're going to be healthier. What's not obvious is how to get people to do that. And the way to get people to do that is often counselors, people, nurses. You may automate everything a doctor does in terms of diagnostics, but in terms of being an authority figure that tells people how to behave, the person who goes and visits the elderly and feeds them, not because they would go hungry, otherwise they could have a robot feed them, but they need the human touch. And so we need, to the extent we need to do something dirigiste, it's we need to pay teachers, caretakers, counselors more. And yeah, okay.
Well, I'll support that.
And musicians.
And yeah. No,
in live performance, your money, your stuff should be free, but your live performances should be expensive.
Yeah, but then you have to sing for your supper for every meal. That's right. Not dignity. I mean, it doesn't work. It's a great theory.
Most people have to work for every meal.
Yeah, but those are the people this foundation is trying to help. I mean, the foundation is trying to help the people who are stuck in the slums in the informal economy, and we're saying that everybody should go into the informal economy.
No, what we're saying is people should expect to work.
Let me talk about what scares me the most. What scares me the most is when big data is combined with big finance. So, in prior waves of the acceptance of a new technology that makes everything more efficient throughout history, it's created a lot of wealth, a lot of new jobs. When networking came along, it created recession and austerity. And the reason why is that our idea about what data is a bad idea. Our idea is that data is this thing that's totally open and free, and whoever has the biggest computer can do the most with it. And so what that means is that a big financial concern, whether it's an insurance company or a hedge fund or a high-frequency trading firm, can calculate the risk away to pretend to be, here's a geeky reference, they can pretend to be Maxwell's demon and make this perfect scheme and radiate all the risk and heat out to everybody else, for those of you who follow that. But the point is, you create this illusion that you have the perfect investment, and then you do really well, except the problem is you're radiating the risk out to the rest of the society until you break the context in which your wealth exists. So we call that too big to fail or whatever. But the thing is, political campaigns have that quality. Insurance companies have that quality now. And in fact, to speak to your point about caring for people, most general practice doctors in the US have become subordinate to various computers somewhere that are calculating what they can submit for insurance and are targeting them, just like a political campaign, with what drugs they're supposed to know about. So
you have an idea on pricing data that's going to help us get around this.
Yeah, I do. I have a solution, sure. So this is something I can't possibly summarize in this setting, but the original idea for digital media going back to 1960 was a character named Ted Nelson, who's a nutcase who I adore. But the original idea for hypermedia, the hypertext from HTML, comes from Ted Nelson, and his thought was that whenever you derive some information that came from somebody else, there'd be a derivative chain stored in the network, and micropayments would flow universally to people, so data would always be valued. So if data is valued, then as we enter an information age, there'll be more and more of this thing called information that is on the books instead of off the books, so the economy will expand instead of contract, and will fund a middle class for perpetuity, no matter how much gets automated. That's the better solution. Now, just stating it so quickly might sound absurd. I do believe that it's a robust answer, but it takes more elaboration.
So we're going to move into question and answer in just a moment. So
okay.
That's going to give people a chance to ask a bit more
sure.
of it. Caitlin, I want to put this question to you as well, and also to Tim. I think Esther's reframed it in a very helpful way. So either what scares you in the space in the way that I'm scared about the consolidation of data into the hands of the very powerful, or what's challenging about unlocking this data? As Esther's pointing out, it's simple to make certain interventions, but it's also very challenging to sort of figure out how we turn big sets of things like genetic information into information that we can use. You're wrestling with companies that are dealing with some of the bigger data sets out there. They're trying to figure out how to turn this into transformative drug discovery, scientific mm-hmm. discovery. What's hard and what's scary?
The thing that probably keeps me up most of nights, and this is going to be, it's going to be really telling for how I've spent the last 7 years of my life, is the broken perception issue and the incentives for all of this. The means of not thinking information is important, I think, is very, very perilous. And it's something that we face not only in academia and also in enterprise, even beyond the scientific world, about people not thinking that the information is of value and instead just throwing that out. But beyond that, not having the know-how to know that it is important or it should be managed, and that, the amount of sloppy science that makes it through the system, even through extensive peer review systems, that no one will go through and check. So take in the life sciences, you get some of the top researchers to go through and review a paper. The likelihood that they ever take that information, go through and try to reconstruct it in the lab, it just doesn't happen. And so it's not necessarily finding this out, and it's not necessarily always malice, but it's just the sloppy research that's getting it made through, and no one is necessarily shining that spotlight bright enough yet on the process to make sure that it changes for future generations.
Tim, we want to hear your anxieties in this space. We want to hear, I know that you're working incredibly hard on getting governments to open data. You put together the Web Index, which is really amazing in terms of both index data and survey data to sort of help us understand the impact the web is having in different parts of the world. And clearly this is an issue on which you're incredibly knowledgeable and passionate. Take a look a little bit at the parts of this where we should be worried, or should we be worried? Is there a version of the consolidation of information that Jaron's worried about, that I'm worried about, that worries you?
I think of the serious threats to the web in general have always been at the top level, being controlled by either a large government or a large corporation, or now the fashion is the two in government industrial complex, in which, in some cases, the large telcos are larger than a lot of governments, They have the ability to move their effort and energy around in different places, to learn from experience in one place and apply it in a country which has never even thought about it, and rapidly impose their version of events on countries which are only just learning to how to exist in a connected world. So in some places, people are more worried about the government spying on them, and in other places, they're more worried about companies, and in some cases, actually, you can't tell the difference between them, just like the pigs and the human beings in Animal Farm at the end of the book. And the threat is not just spying. Of course, it's also blocking. So it's also a lot of places where some places they will just make sure that you can't get to places, to the blogs which will give you the other side of the story from the party line. Other places they will let you go wherever you like, and the moment you do go there, they will put you in jail. So there are lots of nasty ways in which this can happen. So, but the goal is that the idea, the whole. All the beautiful things can be built on top of an open web where when you want to look something up, which may be very, very intimate, you may be wondering about whether you've got cancer, you can click on it knowing that that's not going to change your relationship with the world at all. You can just explore it, and you can even just explore cancer for a friend without getting labeled as it. So in general, it's a sort of, if you like the net neutrality, don't spy, don't block. And the fears are all large institutions. For data, there are less massive concerns. The concerns are generally people just looking at the things which get in the way. There's a massive number of reasons why people don't get it. Why don't treat it the right way? But we should do that in another question.
So. I had warned the panelists that I was basically going to try to ask three questions. I also admitted that if I managed to get through three questions, that Ford had promised me a pony. So knowing full well that I was not going to get through it, but I'm going to go to the audience for the third question. And the third question is really, how does this affect the work that you're doing? We've got this incredible room full of change makers. Whether it's people working on the front lines, whether it's people working as grant makers. Let's get some questions for this panel about some of the implications about the optimistic side, the worried side of big data. Can I get some hands?
And I want to offer one thought, too.
Please, while we get a hand up, offer a thought.
As an empowered panelist. So there are two things. One, it's kind of what Jaron said in another context. If we get really, really good at monitoring data and everything, and we become very democratic, and people are voting all the time, and we've become incredibly short-term, whether it's in the stock market with instant trading, or in government where nobody does anything without counting the number of votes in his or her own district. How that affects you guys is we can now monitor everything, and when you monitor the impact of a foundation, do you start measuring only the things that can be quantified rather than the things that are long-term? So it's great that people are now becoming more outcomes-oriented, but those need to be long-term outcomes.
That's a fantastic question, fantastic point. Yeah. Let's go to a question, please.
Hello, everybody. My name is Tammy Rose, and I'm a user experience researcher. You guys have mentioned usability a few times, and I'm wondering sort of what your fears are about the people who aren't so connected. And how usability will impact them, because it's sort of how savvy you are on the internet sort of depends how much access you have and how much privacy you can get.
I think I'm going to go to the man who invented the web user interface first on this question. Concerns about usability and access to data, Tim?
Well, access, of course, is massive. The reason we started the Web Foundation a few years ago is that we didn't found there was a vacuum in that space. We realized that most of the people people like this were all working to make the web a cooler, more powerful place, get more stuff on there, put more powerful tools on there. And every time they did it, every single thing we do then increases the gap between those who have got it and those who have not got it. And at the time when we started the Web Foundation, it was roughly 20% of the world used the web. And even though lots of people have signal, lots of people have cell phones, there's a huge number of people. So that, yes, I think there's a massive moral imperative to try to make sure that we get the other all the other 80% that want to online on board with some with perhaps, I may be weird in saying this, perhaps low bandwidth. So my, when you look at a lot of the things which are very enabling, if you want to run a business, then in fact, a huge number of things like classically finding out the price of your product in the market over the in the next valley is a classic thing, very enabling, sub-Saharan Africa, for example, or the next port if you're fishing. Those things are a very small number of bits, like getting the weather, like finding out what the current currency conversion is. The number of bits necessary to have a job as a translator, just getting emails in one language and translating them and sending them out, very small number of bits, that's not multimedia. So one idea could be that we should ask that if you're putting in backbone connectivity around a country which is going to support a few people being able to watch high def the debates in HD, watch movies in high definition, that's a ridiculous number of bits you need for that. Shouldn't we, one possibility is to say, let's try to move to a rule that one way or another, those companies arrange that in the cities there should be free Wi-Fi that will get, so that anybody starting a business will be able to do that. That's, that's one idea, but yes, absolutely everything.
I'm going to try to squeeze in one more question before we have to end the session.
Just beware, there's lies, damned lies, and big data. Beware of graphs that don't start at zero, and take that and expand it.
Please.
Hi, my name is Joe Hall. I'm a technologist at the Center for Democracy and Technology. I'm wondering if there are certain things we should keep out of big data realms, like sensitive populations, kids. Court records seem to be particularly interesting in the sense that there are things that we want to have available, but not too available, I would think, and not sort of subject to massive quick calculations. And so I'm wondering if there are other sort of sticky things that you all see as being sort of questionable.
Okay.
Let me do a really quick one. So look, you had a hard time asking the question because it's a really hard question to ask. All of us stumble over it, and the reason why is that for the first time since the advent of market systems and their we're asking policy to cover everything. We're saying we should be able to set policies on privacy and on all these things. It's impossible. It's too much to ask. What markets do is they calculate intermediate zones. So I was talking before about data actually creating micropayments, so it's not free, but is still accessible and affordable because there's less poverty as a result. In that case, the price of data becomes the moderator of the use of data. So that if data is really valuable to some campaign so they can target you for a vote, if they measured you to help target someone else, you get a payment. All of a sudden, they have to balance cause to benefit, cost to benefit. And so if we can monetize data instead of making it absolutely free, we remove some of the burden so that regulation has at least a shot to mean something.
Caitlin, I'm going to give you the last word on this.
Oh, wow. Okay, so very, very quick comment on that. Very, very quick comment on that. Very much so an advocate for being more open than not. And I think that one of the reasons, again, going back to some of the difficulties in getting that question out, is that if you were to go back 10, 15 years ago, that same question had been asked in a certain sense as content was being rapidly made digital, that we never were able to necessarily even think about what the future would be for that. And so it may be that in 2 years, that data is commonplace. It's really natural for that to be made available with certain restrictions. And I've seen more often than not in those discussions, whether it's with that sort of data or some other sort, the restrictions keep people from seeing that innovation or understanding a certain area or a certain sector, and it comes to bite you in the future. And so it's really scary to be able to reach into the unknown and to say, I don't necessarily know how this is going to be used, but let's just take a punt. And we're seeing different industries do that across the board and also, through different sectors and things. And so that would be my final word, is to really, really evaluate before locking down the data whether or not it is as frightening as you think it might be.
So the bad news is we're going to wrap up. The good news is that many of our panelists are going to be around for other parts of the day. I urge you to corner them, talk to them at length. Fascinating ideas. We're just touching the surface here. If I could get a round of applause for our four panelists.
Thank you so much, Ethan. And you'll be seeing Ethan later today. He's going to be presenting on the Media Cloud. I have some good news and some bad news. The good news is that we have the fantastic Jonathan Palfrey, who will be moderating the next panel. The bad news is he has a hard stop for the panel so he can get to a plane to go to another event. So we're going to give you 7 minutes, no more than 7 minutes. Stretch in your seat, answer the call of nature, make friends with your neighbors, and then we're going to get right back into the privacy panel. But don't be late, because Ashkan Soltani will be opening up the panel, and you don't want to miss what he has to show you. Thanks again.